I'm a big fan of shonen. I'm also a big fan of just action in general, whether it be live action or animated. And I always found when watching the best of the best shonen action situations where people are solving things with their fists or feet or what have you, the common thread between all of them is the notion of finding the game in a fight. Obviously, it becomes much more complicated once you bring in things like hockey and other mystical elements, but the game in each fight is what, to me, keeps it interesting. It's why you can have four fight scenes in a movie and not have it feel trite or repetitive.
You're listening to the Mana Podcast from Netflix. I'm your host, Matt Owens. I'm a screenwriter, co-showrunner of the upcoming live-action adaptation of One Piece from Netflix, and, most importantly, a lifelong anime fan. The Mana Podcast stands for Manga Anime Netflix Adaptation, and it's an opportunity for us to talk about our love of all things manga and anime. So I've invited some of my closest friends to chat. We're going to keep this fun and casual, and we're really glad that you've decided to join us. This is the Mana Podcast. And there will be spoilers, so check the podcast description for that list. Today in the studio, a very special guest. A good friend of mine, a fellow blurred. Mason Blurred.
That's what's up.
That's right. That's the moniker.
That's me.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mason Gooding.
Hi, hey, how you doing? Oh, stop the applause. It's so sweet. I don't need any of that.
Mason, why don't you tell the audience a little bit about yourself?
Of course. My name is Mason Gooding, honed through the years of fire and flame of high school bullying for being the biggest. I think blurred is a great word that I'll probably adopt, but moreover than that, I'm just like a lover of so many different things. I think anime and manga maybe being the most passionate of my obsessions and loves. But listen, man, I love Marvel. I love DC. If it's hand-drawn, I'm probably a fan of it. So I'm so grateful for you having me and getting to talk about something I love.
Absolutely. So, you know, when we talk about what are some of the series and things that first brought you into this genre, a lot of us came from Toonami. But so I want to know, for you, other than Toonami, give me some titles. Like, what were you searching through Barnes & Noble and Media Play and all of that? Like, what were some of the early non-Toonami series that you got into?
Well, you have to understand, a lot of what I began watching were things that my older brother would kind of expose me to. I think Toonami is the obvious one. More than that, I think the Four Kids dub of a lot of shows I now have gone back retroactively and re-educated myself on. For those that don't know, Four Kids was a segment of cartoons on Saturdays, I think, on Disney maybe. And they had a lot of shows that would normally be on Toonami edited for a more family-friendly basis. And things like Sanji smoking cigarettes are not going to fly. So I consumed the media in the most kid-friendly way possible, thinking that that was just the way one would watch those shows. So I would say One Piece was a big one starting out. I think the obvious answer, I was a big Pokemon fan. Games first. Yu-Gi-Oh! As well.
Yep, that was Four Kids.
Which only recently did I realize the origin of Yu-Gi-Oh! And how different it is from my perception of like finding in the beginning, and that it was actually about Yami as like a games master, not just cards. You're nodding your head because Matt, no, you can't see him, but Matt is clearly flexing his vast knowledge of things that I'm only just becoming privy to. But Yu-Gi-Oh! Definitely ignited the anime-isms that I think Pokemon kind of shied away from a little bit. I think Pokemon allowed itself to fall into a more, you know, broad spectrum of like, I'm a big fan of shonen. I'm also a big fan of just action in general, whether it be live action or animated. And I always found when watching the best of the best shonen action situations where people are solving things with their fists or feet or what have you, the common thread between all of them is the notion of finding the game in a fight. Obviously, it becomes much more complicated once you bring in things like hockey and other mystical elements, but the game in each fight is what, to me, keeps it interesting. It's why you can have four fight scenes in a movie and not have it feel trite or repetitive.
You're listening to the Mana Podcast from Netflix. I'm your host, Matt Owens. I'm a screenwriter, co-showrunner of the upcoming live-action adaptation of One Piece from Netflix, and, most importantly, a lifelong anime fan. The Mana Podcast stands for Manga Anime Netflix Adaptation, and it's an opportunity for us to talk about our love of all things manga and anime. So I've invited some of my closest friends to chat. We're going to keep this fun and casual, and we're really glad that you've decided to join us. This is the Mana Podcast. And there will be spoilers, so check the podcast description for that list. Today in the studio, a very special guest. A good friend of mine, a fellow blurred. Mason Blurred.
That's what's up.
That's right. That's the moniker.
That's me.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mason Gooding.
Hi, hey, how you doing? Oh, stop the applause. That's so sweet. I don't need any of that.
Mason, why don't you tell the audience a little bit about yourself?
Of course. My name is Mason Gooding, honed through the years of fire and flame of high school bullying for being the biggest. I think blurred is a great word that I'll probably adopt, but moreover than that, I'm just like a lover of so many different things. I think anime and manga maybe being the most passionate of my obsessions and loves. But listen, man, I love Marvel. I love DC. If it's hand-drawn, I'm probably a fan of it. So I'm so grateful for you having me and getting to talk about something I love.
Absolutely. So, you know, when we talk about what are some of the series and things that first brought you into this genre, a lot of us came from Toonami. But so I want to know, for you, other than Toonami, give me some titles. Like, what were you searching through Barnes & Noble and Media Play and all of that? Like, what were some of the early non-Toonami series that you got into?
Well, you have to understand, a lot of what I began watching were things that my older brother would kind of expose me to. I think Toonami is the obvious one. More than that, I think the Four Kids dub of a lot of shows I now have gone back retroactively and re-educated myself on. For those that don't know, Four Kids was a segment of cartoons on Saturdays, I think, on
Disney
maybe? And they had a lot of shows that would normally be on Toonami edited for a more family-friendly basis, and things like Sanji smoking cigarettes are not going to fly, so I consumed the media in the most kid-friendly way possible, thinking that that was just the way one would watch those shows. So I would say One Piece was a big one starting out. I think the obvious answer, I was a big Pokemon fan. Games first. Yu-Gi-Oh! As well.
Yep, that was Four Kids.
Which only recently did I realize the origin of Yu-Gi-Oh! And how different it is from my perception of like finding it in the beginning, and that it was actually about Yami as like a games master, not just cards. You're nodding your head because Matt, no, you can't see him, but Matt is clearly flexing his vast knowledge of things that I'm only just becoming privy to. But Yu-Gi-Oh! Definitely ignited the anime-isms that I think Pokemon kind of shied away from a little bit. I think Pokemon allowed itself to fall into a more, you know, broad spectrum of like what anime was at the time. Whereas Yu-Gi-Oh! Had the spiky hair, the buxom heroines, the maybe potentially unnecessary yelling at things that probably wouldn't elicit much vocal stress. But beyond that, I think it just slowly evolved from there. I read Naruto. This is super long-winded. I'm so sorry, but I do have a long...
That's what we're here for, buddy.
I would hope so, because I've got a lot to say. But I would go to the library by my elementary school, and every so often they would cycle out volumes of Naruto, which if you don't know, the manga of Naruto is exceptional. And I think the anime is great, but what I think the manga for me as a kid did, especially because I was reading them out of order, it's a library, you make do with what you got, that the expositional scenes and his discussion of trying to sway his villains that gets a lot of criticism in the anime.
The talk no jutsu,
the famous talk no jutsu, is maybe to me more palatable when read, because I feel like the thesis statement of Naruto saying like your friends are your power and, you know, community is much more palatable over the course of separate paragraphs rather than a monologue of, you know, emotional fueled anecdotes about the aforementioned friendship and believing it in oneself and whatnot.
Well, speaking of talk no jutsu, that mm-hmm. brings us to the theme of today's episode,
please.
Which is supernatural forces, power sets.
Power sets,
battle,
baby. Friendships.
Anime.
Nakama, dude. That's what we're here to talk about. We're here to talk about just boys loving their boys and girls and sometimes furry creatures that also have anthropomorphic tendencies. That's what we're here to talk about, and I can't wait.
So when we talk about power sets and supernatural force, like, what do you think is the best constructed? I already know what your answer is going to be. What do you think is the best constructed power set or supernatural force in an anime or manga?
For argument's sake, I will say the Nen system in HunterxHunter is, to me, the most, I'll say, versatile as well as compelling power system.
Explain yourself.
I think specifically in the way that Togashi set up, that's the mangaka, Togashi, set up the power system present in HunterxHunter, while also being, in my mind, concise enough that you'll always understand the basis for any future retcons. I think it remains to me the most consistent and easy to follow in terms of the changes that do inevitably come up. It started out as just a bunch of friends kind of experiencing trials and tribulations by way of how they, you know, encountered the rest of the world around them and bringing that into confrontations to solve their problems the best way that they know how. Which to me, even in that first sentiment, was incredibly resonant with me and who I was as a kid. I just appreciated that these characters were using who they are, which may be in direct opposition to the people that they're interacting with, but that that character trait and those characteristics were what were propelling them through adversities and issues that they had in the long run.
I'm with you there. I too gravitate towards simplicity.
Oh, good.
Because I think within simplicity, it allows for the mangaka to have an opportunity to express creativity. Like, for example, My Hero Academia, quirk is a very easy concept to understand.
Right.
But there's no real rule set to how the powers work. It's whatever. There are discussions about,
right,
like, human evolution and
sure,
things like that within it, but it's just people have quirks, and quirks are kind of whatever, you
100%.
Know, Horikoshi comes up with.
But I would draw a very clear distinction between something like a quirk or
a power set that you have to specifically engage with. So another one that I would give then is, which I think is better than the Nen system, is the Jutsu system in Naruto.
See,
it's also
sure,
very simple. There are three types, and that's where everything kind of fits into those categories, and how people use them comes down to bloodlines or creativity or specialization. And
right,
that's a really, I think that's a very simple and yet cool and kind of complex at the same time power set.
See, and what I think HunterxHunter takes the notions kind of brought about by something like a Naruto, although HunterxHunter definitely came up first and precedes it. But Naruto, which has the types of you have taijutsu, ninjutsu, and genjutsu, and it allows from there further tampering and mixing and matching to sort of, I guess, in the long run, produce a statement about character. But unlike HunterxHunter, something like a Naruto, I don't know if the jutsu element of it incites much about who the character is, the way that something like, and now I will get into Nen and the Nen system, as it were, is rooted, to the credit of Togashi, in character first and plot element second. Something like Gon's Jaja Ken, which is basically like a really tricky, violent form of rock, paper, scissors, speaks more to Gon's playful nature and whimsicality that manifests itself as a lethal means of fighting or navigating altercations. I'm not going to say one's better because I don't need people tweeting me to death about how frustrated they are at me, because I am a fan of all of the series we've mentioned so far. But I will say, to me, Togashi's willingness to wipe the slate clean and try something new with his power system, to me, is commendable and furthers a conversation in every battle about how that power system kind of plays culturally rather than just in this fight specifically, which, bless Naruto, but I can't tell you one time fireball jutsu was used to any great effect other than maybe to get someone to move from point A to point B to avoid it.
It's an interesting point, though. And, you know, one, I think in this line of thinking, I think One Piece is actually a really interesting series to talk about, because while the power set in One Piece is devil fruits, mm-hmm. it's only one of every kind, you eat it, you gain a different ability. There are certain characters who have characteristics that apply to their devil fruit.
Right.
Blackbeard is an agent of chaos and destruction, and so having the darkness fruit, that makes a lot of sense. But what I find more interesting in that world is characters who don't have devil fruits and how their fighting styles come about, like what you're saying, strictly from character.
Mm-hmm.
Zoro fights with three swords because he could never beat his childhood friend with just two.
Yeah,
and so this is what he came up with. It was actually Sanji who is one of the things that made me first fall in love with One Piece. The concept of a cook who's a phenomenal martial artist, but he only fights with his legs because if he damages his hands, he can't cook. That's okay. All character. And I thought that was the coolest thing. And it's something this that is consistent. And so I think there's even better examples of that character-focused style of fighting in the One Piece characters that don't have devil fruit powers.
Right. Because it's actually something I wanted to bring up. So that's a great segue. I'm a big fan of shonen. I'm also a big fan of just action in general, whether it be live action or animated. And I always found when watching the best of the best shonen action situations where people are solving things with their fists or feet or what have you, the common thread between all of them is the notion of finding the game in a fight. And if you don't know what that term is, it's because I just made it up just now. Is that when we enter a fight, it could go as simply as I'm stronger than you and faster than you, although that's not true. You can't see it, but Matt is bulging out of his shirt with his rippling muscles, and he's very strong. But in the fake world where I am stronger than him, my strength could lead me to victory in a fight. When I talk about finding the game, it's something like Sanji's complete resilience to using his hands specifically to, you know, keep them safe for cooking purposes. So a fight has to be won in the time it takes him to finish it with simply using his feet. Obviously, it becomes much more complicated once you bring in things like hockey and other mystical elements. But the game in each fight is what, to me, keeps it interesting. It's why you can have four fight scenes in a movie and not have it feel trite or repetitive. I think that's something a lot of superhero movies are kind of dealing with now. I think what I love about HunterxHunter is the same thing I love about series and shows that feel as if they came before me, often because they did, which ultimately means a lot of times I walk backwards into culture and media. Like, I'll watch HunterxHunter and I'll take certain anecdotes at face value, like characters are, you know, transforming and it's actually a negative effect on their well-being. And I'll take that as, oh, that's clearly just the world we live in. It's a bleak world where there's a cost to everything. But Togashi, as a deconstructive work of art, is taking the tropes that came before. In this case, it's like the legendary warrior, I guess you could say, a Super Saiyan, and taking what we know to be true and kind of turning it on its head in specifically in like Gon's transformation into an adult.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, at least for our generation, that relationship to anime is only becoming more interesting as new works of anime start to come out and our peers and contemporaries start making anime themselves from a place of being fans. And I think that's, A, exciting because we get to see an evolution of an art form and a medium. We also get to see new interpretations. I mean, you're doing a live action adaptation of not only the most popular anime and manga series known to man, but it'll have an air of your take and interpretation of not only characters and their characterizations as they exist on the page, but also as they exist in your mind, especially in relation to other manga and anime and adaptations coming out. And to me, nothing is more exciting to hear your take and interpretation on characters like Zoro and Sanji and the way that they fight and interact with other characters, because it reminds me that, first of all, anime is such a fast-growing community, but we also are passionate about the same things. And the things that I can see draw excitement out of you about the anime are the same things that excite me. So at the end of the day, it's like, we'll keep getting new anime that is incited and perpetuated by anime that came before it. And I'm always so excited to see how what came before influences what is yet to come. Because it's changing every day. And it's getting more exciting and more interesting as we go.
And we see that a lot nowadays, right? With some of the more popular series right now, a lot of people like to make comparisons, not necessarily negatively, but to show, oh, people like Kohei Horikoshi and Tatsuki Fujimoto, like you can see the influences in not just anime and manga that came before them, but even Western media that came before. You know, Fujimoto is a massive fan of cult, violent movie, you know,
and you can
Tarantino
tell.
Movies, yes, and even like, tell. You know, when you watch the opening, and there are references to Pulp yeah. Fiction, Big Lebowski, and all of these series, and Horikoshi takes a lot of inspiration from Star Wars.
Mm.
A lot of his cities and prefectures are named after places in the Star Wars universe, and I mean, All For One is a very clear Darth Vader inspired character.
I see what you're saying. Yes, yes.
With the mask and everything.
Right,
yeah.
right.
But what's interesting is that they're taking those things then and applying them back through an Eastern anime and manga lens. All right, let's get into some hot takes.
You've already had some.
All right, so is Nen your favorite power set in anime and manga?
I'd say Nen is my favorite, tied only with the stand system of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure.
Okay. I'll give you that one.
Yeah, man. Come on. Nice.
All right. I'm going to give you a couple. Let's do some rapid fire who would win rounds.
This is the toughest part of the anime community is people always want to talk about who would win.
Look, I'm not a power. Hey. If you've ever engaged in a power scaling conversation with a One Piece fan, it's the worst conversation
battle.
You
That's
will
okay.
ever get into, which is exactly why I'm going to subject you to that right now.
It's fine. You make money.
Well, before I do, just so that I have a little bit of a...
Mm-hmm.
Who do you think is the strongest shonen protagonist?
Can I take Goku off the table? Because it's Goku.
I agree. It is Goku. So let's take him off the table then. Let's take him off the table.
I'll take him off the table and then...
Because I think we got to talk endgame. Like wherever the endgame for a current series that a character exists in, that's what we're going with.
Okay. Because objectively speaking, that is Goku.
I still agree.
Because
yep.
by the nature of the way that story is,
yes.
Close second, I would have to say, I want to say Naruto because of his relationship with Kurama and how that's sort of manifested, but I guess he technically doesn't have, anyway, no spoilers.
His powers are a little different now in Boruto.
At the end of Naruto, which is the show I know.
Yes, end of Naruto.
Yeah.
I might be inclined to agree with you.
I'll take that.
I know One Piece fans will come after me because Luffy's had some insane power-ups
in the last year or two.
But it's
in relativity to like the world they inhabit.
Very true.
And Naruto could probably blow a planet up if he felt so inclined. Not that Luffy couldn't probably find a way to do so, but I'm talking about brass tacks, what I've seen. And I have to probably hand it over to my boy, Naruto.
You heard it here first. Mason Gooding believes that Naruto could beat Luffy.
Great. See you on Twitter.
Yep.
See you there.
You know, one that people really talk about, because I think these two series came out around the same time, and they both had the opportunity to be the next big one after the big three. Who wins, Deku or Asta?
Deku or Asta? I'm going to remain positive. I'm not going to say any... Oh, well, this is hot takes, isn't it?
This is hot takes.
Deku, easy, but not because of any shortcoming that Asta may have. I feel like Deku's willpower and strength in character outweighs Asta, which I'm not caught up in Black Clover. So I will admit I don't actually know the full limitations of Asta's abilities, but I do know Deku's, and I do know he's not short of any physical capability, nor is he any mystical ones, but I feel comfortable with my Deku answer, especially because he doesn't use magic. So Asta's negating of magic does not really apply.
Good point.
So you're kind of just swinging heavy swords around at a dude that can fly and increase velocity at a disgustingly high rate. But that's neither here nor there.
Okay, of the two big newcomers, who wins? Yuji from Jujutsu Kaisen or Denji from Chainsaw Man?
Denji from Chainsaw Man. But, ooh, do I like Yuji?
Can Denji beat Sukuna?
No. I like that about Yuji, though. I like that he's out of his depth at every turn. Because if you look back at what we've seen and what we've read, he's scraping victories from nothing. And I'm always sick. I read manga and I always feel so bad talking about it because I know not everyone does.
Although they should.
But the only time Deku has definitively won, he didn't even get to win. He was about to. And then through outside intervention, the fight came to a conclusion, Yuji being the default winner. But I have to, Denji's, especially when we leave him in part one, virtually unkillable and also just like a bad mother trucker.
Look, I love Yuji. I think he's a really fun character. I think he's one of the drippiest characters in manga right now.
If you colored your hair pink, you'd have his hairstyle.
I do kind of have.
And that's what's sad. It looks good on you too. You can't see him, but don't worry. We'll upload photos to Twitter of Matt dressed as Yuji.
But the other thing, here's the hot, low key, Yuji is barely the main character of Jujutsu Kaisen.
That's what I love about it, though. That's why I love that.
That series is about the three families. It has become so much more about Maki and Megumi and Gojo, even though he hasn't appeared in years.
It's been like a year and a half or something?
Is it a Twitter account? Someone has a tracker, and it's been like over 1,000 days or something
like
that.
When he comes back, he's going to be mad.
It's hard because you can't introduce that powerful of a character and just let him be around all the time.
We want to talk about power dynamics and like how that functions narratively. Take someone like a Gojo, take someone like the de facto strongest and remove them from the table. That's nuts. That's where the real drama and, dramatic situations can stem from. I didn't necessarily see it coming when I was reading it, although it gave a great show of like what his abilities are while he's there. You remove him and now we're however many chapters past and all hell has broken loose. But, I love the device of having him and someone of his power level, a Goku, so to speak, in a room full of Gon freaks is just incredibly compelling to me because eventually you're going to have to get rid of them or eventually they're going to go away because we need stories to be interesting in that respect. And I've loved what came out of that, at least so far. I don't really see that changing, though.
No. Well, all right, so much like Goku, let's take Gojo off the table for a second.
Yeah.
Who's the best teacher character in Shonen?
The best teacher character? It wouldn't be Gojo's. I love him, but he's horrible. But those kids are
Look,
put
most
the
of them are bad teachers. Most of them are bad teachers.
And it's one-to-one with bad fathers in anime. It's great. A lot of really good, strong male representation in the medium. Bisky.
Bro, come on.
I love Bisky.
Come on.
Did you believe me?
You're just saying Hunter Hunter shit just to say it. I know that you do not believe Biscuit is the best teacher character.
Biscuit, I do, but not as the
Even
best
just looking teacher. At Togashi's work, are you going to look me in the eyes and tell me that Biscuit is a better teacher character than Genkai from Yu Yu Hakusho?
No, I'm not going to say that.
I
would have said it if you hadn't called me out on it. It sucks because I have to go with Kakashi because he has...
You don't have to.
No, I do because him and his fight with Obito is maybe the reason I got into a boxing gym and started... talk about character and ideal juxtaposition, like the two of them clashing in the Sharingan universe. Oh my God, thank God I have a girlfriend. Jesus. Jesus. She stuck with me.
Anytime I'm ever dating someone and I accidentally go on like an anime rant, I'm like, please still like
you
me.
Think about it. See, but you got to own that. That's part of who you are. And Amina knows that that's who I am.
That's
and you
true.
Take it in stride and you love him for it. But anyway.
Look, fight is great.
Yes.
The Kakashi and Obito fight is great.
I agree. And I think if you want to get into the minutiae of Naruto, I think it's plausible and feasible that you could argue that the whole show is about Kakashi's failings as a teacher and how he goes about rectifying that for a younger generation. And I don't think that really comes to a head until you learn his backstory. But when you take in the consideration of his pride and his father's ego death that essentially happened, I won't go into it because you need to read that. It's great. I think his arc as a teacher, not just as a character, is to me the most compelling. No offense to Biscuit.
No, you're right. That's what's cool, though. Like, Sasuke was a massive failure from him, but it wasn't his first. He was recreating the mistakes of his friend from his childhood. Like, he failed twice.
Twice.
And both of those failures have come back to bite him in the ass.
Right. And he asked, and how he goes about sort of making amends, not only with the ghosts of his past, but how he still has an opportunity to save Sasuke, even though the biggest left field in anime history is them defeating Kage and all is well and good. And Sasuke's like, well, time to fight to be the Hokage and let's get into it. And that's, hey,
it's the anime equivalent of Ted and Robin having to be together at the end of How I Met Your Mother. It was just they had a decision in their mind and they were like, well, Naruto and Sasuke have to fight at the end of the series. That's just what it is.
It did have to happen. And I cried
it
through each turn of the
anymore.
But
it didn't.
No, because you're right. Narratively speaking, they had made amends. But
so much of that series is about people crying over and trying to save Sasuke.
Yeah.
Look, I love Naruto, but that's just my biggest thing. Because also, I'm not a Sasuke fan. He is not my guy.
Matt, when you inevitably leave us to pursue power in the corporate atmosphere, you know I'm going to have to go and get you back. And I'm going to have to fight so many suits to bring you back to the anime dumb of blurred culture.
Ooh, I love this idea.
Yeah. No, you don't love it that much. Watch, you're going to see Netflix original.
Yeah, it is.
Gone Matt Con. He's still, wow.
I want to see you fight. My wheels are turning.
Oh, look at that, guys. And you saw
the beginning. It has to be an anime.
Matt, it's funny, Matt, you're like allergic to bad ideas. If there's one thing I know about Matt, it's that we'll be up late night watching a show, whether we're in a group or not, and he'll think of something, discuss it in the most scattered way possible, but convince you through way of narrative structure and compelling ideas that it's a great one 10 times out of 10.
I have sent you more than a few late night, possibly drunk voice notes of, I don't know if this is a shitty idea or not, but hear me out.
They're never bad. They're never bad ideas.
You're too kind.
I'm too honest is the problem, because now you're going to get a big head. Next thing you know, you're going to cast some other actor in that lead role, and I'm going to be upset and bitter about it, but that's okay.
Never.
I would hope not. That's contractually binding. You heard it here first, folks.
That is true.
That's okay.
This is evidence.
That's okay.
This is evidence. Okay, so now for this question, I'm taking Nen off the table.
Take it off. We've taken a lot of things off this table.
Goku, gone. Gojo, get out of here. Nen, never heard of it.
Nen, good to see it.
If you could have powers from any power set in an anime or manga that isn't Nen, I must reiterate.
It wouldn't be Nen, though. We can put Nen.
Would it not?
It wouldn't be Nen.
No, I'm not putting it back on the table because this is a trap. I'm going to put Nen back on the table and you're going to snatch it.
Oh. If I could have any power, this is so funny. I think about this all the time. So, like, I wouldn't say one for all because that's like seven different things in one and I don't want to do that.
That'd be a good answer. That's how you game the system, though. That's a great answer.
I don't like that, though. I like the Lemillions that make greatness from nothing. That excites me. And I have to, it would probably be in My Hero Academia because all the other anime that I love are kind of devoid of like power systems in a traditional sense or in that way, in like a power way. But have you read Vigilantes?
Yeah.
You know,
I love Vigilantes.
I don't know what it's called.
The Crawler.
Great. I like that. And the way it's escalated into like basically a Kamehameha of like it's great.
Honestly, people, if you do like My Hero Academia or if you don't like My Hero Academia,
it's
read Vigilantes. Mm-hmm. It was a wonderful series.
How has it not been made into an anime yet? They must be like...
The only thing I can think of is they don't want to cannibalize the brand yet.
They're going to wait
until My Hero is done. Look, the manga could be done soon.
I'm not lipping that it should be. I'm just, you know, lipping over here. Don't worry about it.
Don't worry about it. And then the anime, you know, could be soon to follow.
Yeah.
But I think that will be how they keep the brand alive when the flagship series
ends. It's so lucrative and it's so good. You say cannibalizing, it makes it sound as if they'd be reaching or that they'd be trying, but like...
No, just in the sense of it will be a way, rather than having two series on at the same time, which would be successful, when one is done, then do another so that the brand continues to be
spoken
successful.
Like a true marketing expert.
People,
look at that.
Look, it is a business.
Yeah. Yeah.
It is a business.
Really and truly. But I love his Pie the Craw. I love that. But that will be my answer because of its versatility. As long as I work at it, you know, I love going to the gym. I love working out and pushing my limits, breaking through them. I feel like I could take something like that and make it really neat, you know? That's my, what's your, I feel like you have a better one. Is this what you meant by you're like, oh, I'm going to blow it out of proportion in a minute or whatever you said?
No. I was saying this was a trap on your part because if I allowed you to say nen, I feel like you would just out of spite.
I might have. out of spite. Out maybe of that spite. Sounds in character.
That's just, your truest power set, Mason.
I just, yeah, that's my, yeah, spite. I just don't know if nen lends itself to the power fantasy, especially as a deconstruction of other power systems. I don't know if any of them are meant to be like, hey, wouldn't you want this? Like, no, I wouldn't want to tase myself and then get electrical abilities. I'm so sorry, but I thank you for the offer. I think a kid version of me would have loved the whole Shaman King shtick of having the ghost aspect. Mm-hmm. It's been a minute. Because I would have loved to have a friend to talk to. That got really sad, but it's true. And then I'd like fight with him side by side. I like to think my dog is my ghostly apparition that fights by my side.
Shout out to Iggy.
Shout out to Iggy.
The
dude.
Great one.
Ah, oh, the great Iggy. Anyway.
The great one.
No, but nen is great. I just don't know if I would.
For me, Pokemon notwithstanding, because that will still be my answer.
That's great. That'd be sick.
I don't care. I'm a 35-year-old man, and if I could live in the world of Pokemon, I would do it in a heartbeat.
Although, like, what if you did make that deal with, like, a genie, and you're like, I want Pokemon, and instead of getting Pokemon, you just got Pokemon abilities? Like, you just could, like, fall asleep and then use sleep talk and, like, hurt people or, like, use Thunderbolt or Earthquake. Would that be ideal, or are you like...
I'd find peace.
I'd make Pikachu. Okay,
I'd make
great.
Peace. Good. So if Pokemon doesn't count...
Right.
I referenced it before. I think... It would be Cardcaptor Sakura because 52 different abilities at your disposal and the ability to use them, mix and match them. It's like by the time Sakura gets to the end game of the first series, she can do anything.
Mm-hmm.
It's one of those power sets that's kind of like limited by your imagination. And like once she really taps into her magical abilities and gets used to it and stuff, I think that's it. Because I can control elements. I can jump. I can fly.
You want the most amount of power at one time.
Not from a power standpoint, though, from a practicality. Because I'm also assuming...
You're so funny.
Seriously, though.
What if I'm lost in the desert and I need to start an engine? I have to use... Okay.
Yeah.
Wow,
and
look at him.
Yes, and I can. I'm thinking, what power said would I want in the real world? It's that one. Again, she can fly. If I get in a fight, guess what? I can bust out the fight card or the power card, and I'm good to go.
See... Okay, this is great because this is technically the topic of what we're talking about. Do you not feel as if that neuters a lot of the dramatic tension of any fight scene if your potential for options in a fight, and this could, I guess, go beyond anime, is limitless. If you can do anything, when I'm watching or reading, I feel myself going, why don't you just do this? Why don't you do that? Why don't you do this? Why isn't... But when I see someone with a very limited set of skills stretch and push their limits to a point where they're now thinking on their feet using a great example, bungee gum has both the properties of bungee and gum. It's
man's out here selling. Man's out here hawking bungee
you're
gum.
You're damn right. But you think about it, and the lengths that show and manga go to add versatility to what is a very specific set of skills, to me becomes inherently compelling and incredibly exciting to read because it's just how does this become? I mean, I'll use vague concepts, but you've got a mace, an impromptu mace used by someone's head and bungee gum and a finger. To me, that's nuts. But if you knew that they could, my ability is I can turn the air off and you will suffocate. And I also can fly. I'm like, okay, well then do all of that and just run the world.
Well, sure. There's a difference between what I want in my media and what I want in real life. I just want to be an all-powerful magical girl,
that's
Mason.
Right. I would say you are the closest thing to that I've known.
Thank you. But yeah, in media, you have to have limitations. And that kind of goes back to differences between Eastern and Western power sets is... A lot of times, I think Dragon Ball Z notwithstanding, that is the greatest definition of power creep that I think we have in anime and manga. But there are a lot of limitations to power sets and what people can do in certain series that I don't think necessarily exist in Western media. Because especially if you look at where the MCU is now, people are like, well, why didn't Doctor Strange just use an all-powerful spell? Like, why didn't he do this? Why didn't he call in the other event? Like, there aren't the same limitations, it feels like, that are purposefully put in place to help answer the questions of, well, why can't this all-powerful person just do an all-powerful thing?
Right. And that, it's so funny because, first of all, that leads to Twitter's best moments of, like, debunking movies based on, like, what was that thing that gained all that traction on Twitter about Ant-Man crawling up Thanos' butt and...
and then just growing large and killing Thanos from inside. Large? And you're like, technically, according to the rules, that could work.
But at the same time, I don't... I'm not about to justify that as a means by which to end the... Could you imagine the world's most winningest and successful IP ending in anal evisceration? I do think, specifically for...
Can you recover from that?
I have no idea. I'm going to try, though. I like, in a lot of Eastern properties, the rule set and power set, as we've established, becomes set from a very early point, or at least at some point in general, and it doesn't necessarily progress beyond that without very specific moments of growth being conveyed to the reader. I look at something like a JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. I'll use Stone Ocean because that's the most recent anime chapter or season, show, series. In Jotaro, Kujo gained the ability to stop time for a prolonged amount of minutes, maybe, probably seconds, and still... is bested by I don't remember if the season's finished, so I won't spoil anything, but a number of adversaries to a point where he's rendered out of the fight for a large portion of episodes, if not the entire rest of the season, despite having this altruistic intent and all-encompassing power of stopping time. You take something like Doctor Strange, who does have a lot of capabilities of, like, world-ending proportion. And I think what I love about Marvel and in a lot of ways DC is what stops them from doing those things is almost always morals and, like, what's right. And I could do this, but it's better if I don't because I can solve it with... I guess that was the big thing in No Way Home, right? Was Doctor Strange finally was like, no, I gotta do this. And Spider-Man was like, no, but I can do this a better way. Great character writing. but I don't know if I'm hard pressed to think of. I mean, can you think of an anime where they're like, where the protagonist is like, I won't kill? I don't know if that's ever been like
a bunch of them. Are you kidding? That's no, like part of the cornerstone of My Hero Academia. That's like the big thing that they're even reckoning with in the war arc now. It's like, man, if heroes would just kill horrible villains, we would not be in the places where we are now.
And this could just be my ignorance. Is that as core a statement made by the author in the way that it is in DC and maybe Marvel too? When they were making the initial comic books, there was a rule in the, like, I don't know what the, like, the MSRP of that time was, but they were like, superheroes can't kill. If someone does something wrong, it has to be rectified by the end of the issue. So Batman's, like, no killing rule comes from a general rule that comic book characters aren't allowed to kill, if you guys didn't know. So that's why it feels to me black and white. Batman doesn't kill and should never, unless you have, like, very extenuating circumstances in his latter years. But something like a My Hero Academia, you have examples where characters are actually killing for the greater good and it ends up biting them in the butt.
It has happened. I think especially early on, it was something that was very clearly stated from some of, like, the teachers and the pro heroes and stuff. Is this is a thing that separates us from them. We have seen examples, which I agree with, where that has changed. Hawks killing, this isn't spoilers now because it happened in the anime. Hawks killing twice was a good thing.
Wow. You think?
Yes. Twice his ability, and especially after—
Is a problem.
No, Awakening is One Piece. But when he gained the ability to just multiply himself to near infinity, That's
yeah,
that's
we gotta take
bad.
That off the table. We gotta
yeah, we gotta get
twice
rid of
is
this
off
guy.
The table. Yeah,
we gotta get rid of this guy. So there are examples where I understand the moral. I don't want to call it grandstanding necessarily.
Sure.
Although sometimes it feels like
it. Yeah, it could be.
But this is what separates us from them.
Right.
I understand that argument to an extent.
Right. Without spoiling anything, have you read the manga? Are you caught up?
Oh yeah.
And you still think? Okay. I'm just curious.
Yeah.
No, that's great, man. That's great for you. We just wouldn't be on the same superhero team. That's fine. That's okay.
That's all right.
I actually would miss you. I would not want to be on a superhero team without Matt.
You can be my sidekick.
All right. What's your next question? I felt like an affront on my being.
So, Mason, tell me and our audience, what are you watching and reading right now that's got you most excited? Any genre, anything.
Yeah. I'm reading Vagabond because some generous individual soul is selling the entire series on eBay. And I bought it and it sat on my counter for months. And then I was like, on a whim, I collect manga, by the way. I collect Taikabon. I have hundreds of those.
You should see this man's bookshelves.
It's almost depressing for my accountant. I've been reading that and been hooked. I got a tattoo to commemorate it because it really moved me, which if you don't know, I have a bunch of anime tattoos. And it's so funny being online and like reading Twitter and people being like, what is that from? And the disappointment that they feel when I'm like, it's from this anime at this point, this character does this. But it's also really nice to see people that get it and they get excited to see that level of fandom in, you know, in someone they haven't met or someone they don't know. But what am I watching? I like to say a little bit of everything. Willow on Disney Plus is great. It's a really good actor. I'm Tony Revolori on that. He's great.
Never heard of him.
That's so funny. You should. He's great. You'd love him.
No, I do. That's not even a good joke. I love that man dearly.
That's right. That's what I'm talking about. Aside from the newest season of Grey's Anatomy, what else am I watching? I love you, Addie. Spy Family, I've been behind on and I'm catching up on that. I hadn't watched Daredevil and the other pre-MCU television shows. I actually got into those. And those are great. That might be the Daredevil fight scene. And I know stunt guy, I've talked to stunt guys that are like, oh, I hate when people bring that up because it's such a specific. The Daredevil hallway fight scene is maybe the pinnacle of action storytelling in television. I haven't watched enough movies to really speak on that, but I think that's my answer, by the way. But kind of in the context of what we're talking about, power scaling and fighting and power systems, the fact that Daredevil has nothing aside from his